Dealing with the one who transcends all things. last week we talked about God and an aspect of him we probably don't really consider too often. That is the fact that he's really an independent with himself. He doesn't really need anything outside himself, and yet he involved himself in creation. He created because he loves, and he loves to create, and he wants us to share with him. Even though we won't add that much to him, but we can gain a lot from him. So really, in that relationship, we're the winners all the way around. But it's difficult to always think about that, because practically everybody we know needs something or somebody. And we, you know, John Donne said, no man is an island. Well, God could very well be an island. It wouldn't make any difference to him. But he's not an island, because he's involved us in his creation. And so therefore he wants to be involved in our lives. So we talk about this word transcend, and God transcends, the transcendence of God. Isaiah chapter 40 verse 22-24 says, it is God who sits above the circle of the earth. The people below must seem to him like grasshoppers. He is the one who spreads out the heavens like a curtain and makes his tent from them. So God is outside of our creation. God is outside of our visual understanding of him, and he's outside of time also. He is a transcendent one, one that is above all things. A couple of little interesting things on this. You know, sometimes when we think about the relationship of us with animals, and we think their lives are so far removed from our lives, what do they really understand about us, and in some cases what do we really understand about them? And yet the difference between an animal and us is far, far less than the difference between God and us. God is a supreme being that is so far above anything that we can experience and knowledge and have knowledge of, to be able to put in a box, to be able to understand everything about him and put it in a box. We like things, we like to know things, we like to understand things and be able to say, yes, I understand that. I can put that to one side. But we can never do that with God, because no matter what we understand about God, it is very limited in our real knowledge. This last part of that verse there, he's the one who spreads out the heavens like a curtain and makes his tent from them. There's two major theories that the evolutionists use on as regards to the world. And the one we're most familiar with is the Big Bang Theory. And that is, it's from a speck and everything's blowing out in all directions. But in some of their investigations and the astrophysicists and stuff like that, there is a competing philosophy, if you will, within the evolutionary circle. Because the way the universe seems to be, it's more like, rather than from an explosion, it's more like a curtain, like it folds in a curtain. It's all to do with redshift and stuff like that. But they really are not too sure about it, but they think that may be a better description of the universe. You don't hear about that one too often, because that's not the popular one. That's one of the other ones, okay? But it's interesting, you hear God saying he spreads out the heavens like a curtain. And there's a lot of stuff in the physics world that seems to be better view of things,
little
things.
You're thinking, yeah, well, the word curtain in that verse in Hebrew is rakia, and it means a thinness, an extenuation.
Yeah, but it's got the idea of like a fold, not a fold that way.
It's not solid, like the firm, like they have the idea of the firmament.
They used to think that I was solid up there, and there was a little hole poked in it, and that's the lights coming through the holes that were poked in the solidness of the earth. That's some people thought about, yeah. But that's not biblical. Yeah. Okay, he judges the great people of the world and brings them all to nothing. They hardly get started, barely taking root when it blows in them and their work withers. The wind carries them off like straw. And this verse is really contrasting the eternalness, the awesomeness, the power, the majesty of God with the fleetingness of man's life. And even the best or the most important people that we can think about our leaders, whether we think of them as important or not, as far as the world is concerned, you can think about the leaders of the nations as being the elite, that's about as big as you can get.
Yeah.
And God says, well, really, even the very top people that you think of, the leaders of the nations you think of, it's temporary. Everything, they get home with something that they hardly get started in life, and their life's over, and it just withers away, In contrast to the eternity of God, the infinity of God, the transcendence of God, we in our little lifestyles, in our little life, 70 odd years or 93 years, 91 years when you're very fortunate and that type of thing, even though to Frank it may seem like a lifetime, which it is, In the realms of what we know of our civilization, it's a drop in the ocean. But in the realms of what God is, God knows, it's just, a speck. And that's interesting. That's why the psalmist says, what is man? And how you're mindful of man. God, why do you even bother with us? We're like little specks. Why do you even bother with us? How on earth did you love us enough to send your son to die for us? Which is amazing, really. So God's saying, you may be in the terms of infinity, in the terms of transcendence, you may be nothing, and your life is very, very short and doesn't seem to amount to much. But he says, you're still important to me because I'm your creator. I made you. And I want you to get the best out of the life that you have. And I want you to share your eternal, everlasting nature with me. Okay, so but sometimes when you're young, you don't think of death. You don't think of usually you don't even hear of a lot of people dying when you're young, and then you hear a lot of marriages, a lot of marriages. But as you get older, you suddenly find yourself at more and more funerals, and at the tail end of your life, of more people dying off than you hear of people being born and you're familiar with. As time just changes. So even our perception of our lives changes as we grow up. But we have a great God. This is what the Bible wants you to understand. The maker, the creator, the one who transcends all things. He is a great and awesome, powerful God. He is like none other. He is a God above all gods. Whatever man can imagine, God is greater than that. He is above, he is supreme, he is exalted. He is a place that none can approach. He is a being that none can strive after or even find until he has revealed himself. Interesting, powerful word, really. Ecclesiastes 5:2 says, do not be hasty or impulsive in thought to bring up a matter in the presence of God. For God is in heaven and you are on earth. Therefore, let your words be few. Sometimes we, it's in our prayer life, sometimes we must feel like badgering God, sometimes the things that are happening in our lives seem so important to us, but in the realm of time and eternity, even our biggest challenges are as specks. And I like the writer who says, this too shall pass. When you go into something and when you're in the middle of something, you don't even see that. Can't imagine. This is you're going through this situation. There seems to be no end. There seems to be no way out. There seems to be no, you can't even see any light at the end of the tunnel. And yet, maybe a couple of years pass, and suddenly you think, goodness, I'm through it. I'm out the other end, and I'm picking up my life. I'm beginning to put the pieces back together. We couldn't see that when we were in the middle of it. But now, even in our lives, some people's lives go from tragedy to tragedy. Some people's lives go from pillar to post, and just almost batter from one situation to another, that's tragic, really. But when you look back at it, it's a lot of time it's made you stronger. It's developed your experience. It's helped you to be more caring and considerate of other people because you've experienced that much more. And if in all sorts of situations, if you have a problem, you want to be talking to somebody who understands your problem because they've been there. You don't want somebody who really doesn't know anything about the situation. The people who can identify with you best about a situation is ones who have already gone through that situation. And therefore they know the struggles and traumas you've had. So to say, you can't understand without having to go through everything. You know, I don't really want to die to be able to come back and tell the people, see people. I can understand death, because I've done it. I don't want to, you know, go that far. But there are certain things that you do go through in life which you benefit from that experience and you can pass on from that experience. So God exists apart from creation. He is totally other, totally outside of. He is totally different from creation. And he also, one of the main characteristics that we're going to deal with a bit later on, is he is a holy other. So part of the very being of who he is contains this concept of holiness. Samuel 2 says, there is no one holy like the Lord. Indeed, there is no one beside you, nor there is any rock like our God. There's just nothing in our experience that can really open up our minds to really understand who God is. God exists apart from his creation, he's totally other. He is a holy other. Isaiah 42:25 says, to whom then will you liken me, that I would be his equal, says the Holy One. You know, who can you compare to God? There's nothing in your experience can compare to God. Because of the transcendence of God, because of this awesomeness and this holiness, he should inspire us with reverence and awe. And sadly, sometimes our very familiarity with God, we lose that little bit of reverence for God. Because we begin to take it for granted. And that's tragic, you know. If the first time I remember going to an airport and seeing security guards there in Britain with machine guns. And I thought, wow, you know. And, you know, you give them a wide berth just in case, you know. But once you go through the airport a few times, what happens? It becomes like wallpaper. It's just part of the background. And sadly, sometimes in our life and our relationship with God, you know, when we first begin to understand who God is, and we first understand he loves us, and he wants to save us, and he would prepare to die for us, and that's, wow, you know, that's, wow. But after you've been to church a few times, and Sunday morning service a few times, and, you know, you say, well, you know, what are you doing? I'm going to worship God. You know, go on. What? Really, it's tragic, isn't it? When we lose that sense of the awesomeness and the power of the one we're going to talk to on a Sunday morning and the worship on a Sunday morning.
I think we miss it on Sunday morning.
Yeah,
I think we do. We don't prepare ourselves for the service to begin. You know,
should quiet ourselves, settle ourselves down, contemplate.
Sit down. We're walking about the place and chatting all the time. There's a lack of reverence, I think.
We went to stop you the week.
Again, you can do that with a small congregation, for the group, a small group. But with a large congregation, you have almost inevitably more reverence.
Yeah.
People come in and sit down, and that's it.
Okay, Isaiah 6, verse 1 is a passage we're going to see time and time again through this study, because it's such a powerful passage. In the year, Isaiah says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, lofty and exalted, with his train of his robe filling the temple. Seraphim stood above him, each having six wings. With two he covered his face, with two he covered his feet, with two he flew. And one called out to another and said, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. That's a, you know, that's a passage Rebbe should read every Sunday morning as we come into his presence, okay? Remind ourselves of the awesomeness and the power and the majesty of the God that we come to worship.
Yeah.
And we'll see Isaiah's response to that a little bit later on. The foundation of the threshold trembled at the voice of him who called out, for the temple was filled with smoke. And I said, woe is me, for I am ruined. I am a man of unclean lips. I live among a people of unclean lips. For mine eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. You know, the contrast between God and us. He is so holy, majestic, and compared with him, we're rubbish, basically. You know, but isn't it wonderful that that vision of God, it's the same God who loves us, same God prepared to die for us, same God who wants us to spend eternity with Him. Now, I know some people, fortunately, now that I'm a little bit older, I'm a little bit more patient in some ways. There are some people who I might have not been too keen to spend much time with in my earlier days. Whereas now I can, you know, I can understand a little bit more, and maybe I'm more prepared to, I'm trying to understand where they come from and how they ended up in that situation. I'm maybe prepared to be a little bit more patient with them. But God wants to spend eternity with you and with me.
Mm.
You know, why does He bother?
Mm.
Why does He bother? Yeah.
No.
Your neighbor's going to be in heaven maybe one day.
I'm going to say, there's an awful lot of people who actually need imagery to make them reverent.
Yeah.
You know, for example, going into a Catholic church with all this imagery, and that sort of calms them down and makes them
think,
believe that they are in the presence
of
something.
That's right. I mean, a lot of that came about because a lot of people couldn't read. A lot of that was it really the story of Jesus in visual form for people who couldn't read the story of Jesus in a written form. So some of that was helpful.
The amazing thing at the end of that passage is
that's
the God on the throne,
but
He's the one who says, who shall I send and who will go for us? God's asking.
I know, he doesn't say, hey you,
get
up.
And the man has been terrified, woe is me, here am I, send me.
Yeah. Willing to serve.
That's right, absolutely.
It's a beautiful, we're going to come back to it quite a few times over the next couple of weeks.
Yeah.
But it's a powerful passage, and it's one it does. I mean, these are the kind of passages we ought to read regularly in order to contemplate the kind of God that we have to worship on a Sunday.
Mm.
So we should be inspired and reverence and all. First Timothy 6, verse 15, 16 says, for at the right time, Christ will be revealed from heaven by the blessing and only Almighty God, the King of kings and Lord of lords. He alone can never die. He lives in light so brilliant that no human can approach Him. No one has ever seen Him, nor ever will, to be honour and power forever. Amen.
What translation is that, Graham?
It's a modern English translation.
When
I'm doing home Bible studies a lot of times, and I had the authorized version, I spent so much of my time trying to explain the verse, thought, I'm not going to do that. And actually, I've been quite pleased with some of the way that the translator has handled some of these. I'm selective. I've got about 16 different translations to choose from to put into the text. And so it depends on how they put the text. Is it helpful or is it detract from the text? One of the problems you have is because though my memory is rubbish, I still have lots of memory verses from the authorized verses go through my head. So like that one, the Isaiah one, and other passages like it. I'm reading this the modern text. I think it's just not quite the same. But having said that, it's more important for the people who haven't got that background to be able to understand what they're reading rather than say, what's this? I can't understand this stuff.
Having said that, I've got to admit that the old language is more beautiful than the modern English.
Yes. So I've gone for the understanding rather than for the, and hopefully the clarity of understanding.
Yeah.
So I've been kind of quite selective, but I've tried, as a matter of fact, sometimes if I have used the authorized version, what I've done is I've changed the thou's into you, taken off the bits that make it awkward for people, even though I've stuck to the actual text itself. So it depends what the passage is and what the passage is trying to convey. I've tried to be helpful with it rather than detract from it. But as you say, for older people who are brought up in the King James Version, then it, it, you know, the Because the contrast is quite extreme.
Yeah.
Because in your mind you're going through the text with it, and suddenly you're thinking, On Thursday night, on Wednesday night, I do a study with Kuda and Taffy.
Who?
Joe's two kids.
Oh, I
and,
see.
And one of them has got, it's like the Revised Standard Version, and the other one has got a children's Bible. But it's amazing how well the children's Bible has actually helped to actually convey the actual meaning.
Mm.
It's been pretty good. I've been impressed so far. There's some areas, obviously, as with everything. But it's interesting. You know, it helps sometimes to clear things up. Because she actually said to me, now that I'm older, I should really get a different Bible.
Yeah.
But as I was listening to the text, I said, you stick with that Bible, because for your everyday reading, stuff like that, it's excellent. A lot of times it really does a good job, and I was quite impressed. It's not the NIV, it's actually a children's Bible. But the text is very, very good. Anyway, we're talking about God, King of Kings, Lord of Lords, all power and glory. Job says, can you discover the depths of God? Can you discover the limits of the Almighty? They are as high as the heavens. What can you do? Deeper than Sheol, what can you know? Its measure is no longer than the earth and broader than the sea. Measure is longer than the earth. He says, you know, when you try with God in a box, he says it's just impossible, because God is outside and bigger than any box you could ever imagine. And our trying to come to terms with who God is a bit like trying to put God in a box. He continued, 36, verse 26, behold, God is exalted. We do not know him. The number of his years is unsearchable. I mean, we talk about eternity. What does that mean to you? Can you describe it? Can you put enough numbers on it?
Mm.
You can't.
He isn't old, is he?
No.
He's just now.
He's outside time. It's meaningless, you know? So we like things we can nail down. We like things we can describe. And when we deal with God, he's outside practically everything we can try to do. And we can only touch the hem of the garment. Psalm 97 verse 2, clouds and thick darkness surround him. Righteousness and justice are the foundation of his throne. He doesn't lie. He deals in truth. He deals in righteousness, right thinking and right living. And he deals in justice, and his justice can't be bought. It is incorruptible justice, and it is proper justice. Sometimes when we come to a decision about something, we base that decision upon what we know. But sometimes there are some facts that weren't revealed when we're making that decision. And so the conclusion we come to was right compared to what we know. In actual fact, we've taken the wrong conclusion, because we hadn't seen these other facts. When God's justice is enacted and he comes to a conclusion, it's because he sees all the facts. There's nothing missing. There's nothing he can add to change the argument. And therefore, his justice is true. And that's just, again, something we don't deal with, because practically every aspect of our lives, there's some things we don't know. In every decision we make. So we do the best we can, what we can, but really, the Psalms again, 145 verse 3, great is the Lord and highly to be praised. His greatness is unsearchable. You know, when you describe somebody as being great in a human terms, we can think of lots of things that qualify that greatness. But when we think of greatness of God, there's just nothing we can qualify that can help us to really define what it means when we talk about the greatness and awesomeness of our God. Isaiah 40 verse 28, do you not know? Have you not heard? The everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, does not become weary? He's never tired. His understanding is inscrutable. You know, I don't know about you, but there are lots of days when I get tired. You know? in Jesus, God in the flesh, even he got tired in his humanity. But he was only a so far removed, if you like, because he's one of us, from the God of the Father, who is outside of our knowledge. And God never gets tired. If I made a universe in 6 days, I think I'd be ready for a seat. You know, I'd be sweating at least. But his awesomeness, his power, it just doesn't work in our human terminology. Mm. God doesn't get tired. He upholds the universe. He keeps the whole thing going. You see how big it is? And a comet going past us as we speak. And you see how big it is? And he says, by the word of power, by his word, it was brought into existence, and it's sustained by his word.
It's probably deliberately made it in 6 days or 7 days. No, just
like that.
Yeah,
what are you going to do today, God?
Deliberately took his time for it, isn't it?
it's crazy, really. You are a God who hides himself, O God of Israel, Saviour. There's a lot of stuff involved in God that we don't know. But there's an aspect that he has revealed himself. He's a God that wants our salvation. And that's going to be good news. Mm. He's on our side. God, Saviour. As for my thoughts, not your thoughts, nor are my ways your ways, declares the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways. My thoughts higher than your thoughts. You know, can you outthink God? Can you outguess him? Just a little starter. And I often think in my judgments of certain things that I've come to judge, that I wouldn't do things like God does, you know. Some of the things that some of us human beings get up to, you know, I certainly wouldn't be as patient as God is. I can honestly say practically every second day I catch myself thinking about something or someone or some situation, thinking, I'm thinking away, blah, 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 I'm stopped thinking, goodness, there but for the grace of God go you. You know, why on earth, why are you so judgmental on that?
Because I'd down the toilet, wouldn't I?
You'd be back on the sharks. You'd go with the sharks. That's an in-joke. anyway, reality is, you know, we forget how our own weaknesses. We forget some of the things we've done. And then we look around at some others and think, God, and God, you know, why didn't you come in judgment on these situations, on these people? And then we think, goodness, you know, if you did that with me, I would be in bad trouble. You know, goodness gracious me. Romans 11, 17, Paul's mind is blown away. It's almost like, I think we talked about this the other week as well. He's sitting there, he's writing Romans chapter 9 through to 11, dealing with the Jewish situation, and they're complaining, God is unjust, that he's thrown us away because he's allowing salvation to the Gentiles, and we're being left out. And Paul's writing this, 9, 10, 11, and he comes to the end of it, and he looks back at what he said, that's amazing, God's done, how God has managed to do that, he's just. And he says, oh, the depths of the riches, the wisdom, the knowledge of God. How unsearchable is the judgments? Unfathomable anyway. He's blown away. Mm. The apostle's blown away with what he understands of how God, in his justice and his mercy, have balanced out the situation between Jew and Gentile. It's mind-blowing, he says. He's an awesome God. You know, if we can just keep a hold on a daily basis of some of those thoughts, what a difference we make in our lives. What a challenge would be to every day waking up and recognize, this is the God who loves me. This is the God who wants to walk with me. And this is the God who ultimately wants to save me and spend eternity with him. Absolutely unbelievable. So it should inspire humility. If our concept of God is right, then sometimes our view of ourselves might be modified by that. We no longer think we know everything. We no longer think we don't need anybody. We no longer think that we can do everything by ourselves. We recognize that, you know, without God, we're nothing. And that ought to bring humility. God is unknowable in two senses. We can't know it all without divine revelation. If God hadn't revealed what he was thinking and what he wanted, we wouldn't know about him. We can know something about him, but only when his thoughts are revealed. 1 Corinthians 2 verse 11, and he says, who among men knows the thoughts of a man except the spirit of the man which is in him? Even so, the thoughts of God, no one knows except the spirit of God. I don't know what, you could be, you're supposed to be listening to my class, okay? But you could be thinking, you know, McCann needs a service this next week. I wonder if the guys will be I don't know what you're thinking. And if you don't tell me what you're thinking, I can't guess it. I might, you know, think, well, he looks like he's paying attention, but your brain could be anywhere. Mm-hmm. Unless you communicate. Unless you let me know. I think this is boring, I'm going home. Unless you communicate, I don't know. If we can't do that with you and me, what an earth chance we've got in understanding who God is and how God thinks if he doesn't communicate himself.
Well, I'll tell you what I'm thinking. I don't understand how God can say he's appointed a day when he's going to end it all. Mm-hmm. It just, I can't grasp that. Oh, but he's the someday that the earth is not going to be anymore.
Well, when you think about it,
what's the crack?
When you think about it, I mean, he's made it and had a point in time beginning, but ultimately it's going to fall apart. It's like a car.
Can't fathom the reason.
Well, can you think of would you ever imagine a couple of years ago trading your car in?
What?
Would you ever imagine trading your car in for a new car?
Yeah, I can imagine it, but I'm not going to do it for
economic reasons. But you did last time because you've got this one.
No.
But that last one, you were really pleased with that last one, weren't you?
Yeah.
How many years do you have it?
7 years.
7 years. And yet there was a point where that car, even though it was good when you didn't buy a rubbish one, did you? No. You thought you were buying a good one.
3 years old when I got it.
There you are, you see. So you, in your mind, when you bought that, it was everything you needed for the purpose you needed for. Mm-hmm. But as time goes on, it then comes to the point where it's no longer fit for purpose. The world is going to come to the point where, especially with humanity, we're no longer fit for purpose. Mm. Peter, the writer, turns around and says to Peter, you know, oh, everything's going on the same. You know, we're marrying, we're giving in marriage, we're partying, we're doing all this. You know, God's gone off. He's not worried about us. He's not going to care about us. And Peter says, God is patient. In fact, he uses the word in the bottom of the bed. He is long-suffering towards us. And, you know, he gives us every chance he can get. But don't take that patience for weakness. Because there is a time when he's going to say, right, I've given them long enough.
Peter says that, you know, they talk about global warming and everything burning up.
Yeah.
Peter says that. He says that the earth that now is, it was for a day of destruction, when the elements will melt with fervent heat. The heavens will pass away with a great noise. The earth and all the works in it will be burnt up.
Yeah.
But then, what kind of people ought we to be?
That's right.
Looking for these things. It's got a built-in, what's that? What's the word I'm grappling
with?
The whole system has a, not like the Americans, built in this depreciation, so it doesn't last too long.
Yeah.
God's done that with the earth.
Yeah, it's got built in obsolescence, that's right.
Using fuels up, aren't we? Using the fuels up,
yeah.
Diminishing.
Yeah.
It's not replaced.
Yeah.
It's not really replaced.
We keep drilling all these holes in it because we had cheese going
fracking,
in
fracking.
At some point. Anyway, so God's got a purpose for mankind. Yeah. The thing is, the good thing is, he wants us to be with him when that happens. He doesn't want us to be on here when that happens. He wants us to be with him. And Jesus says, you know, before that happens, I'm coming back.
Yeah.
So he's got a day for that. Now, when is he going back? Well, he's patient. And I'm thankful he's patient, because sometimes I need a bit of time to be right with God. And thankfully, he's given us the opportunity through Christ to do that, to be right with God. But I've got a lot of people I know who are not right with God. They need a little bit of time as well. And to be, you know, I can be self. I don't know why, when I became a Christian, God didn't sit and say, right, that's you, you're a Christian, bang on the head, that's it, go home. That would have saved me an awful lot of hassle. I wouldn't have had to pay to prepare these classes. You know. If he could get me when he had me hot off the press, when I saw him in clarity, when I recognised my sin, when I realised the cost of my salvation, when I was amazed and in love with Christ because he'd saved me, that's the way to go. Don't wait till I get tired and jaded and think, good, I'm going to go to church again. Good, you know, that's not a good idea. You know, he should have taken me when I was hot. But the problem is, he's got a job for us to do. He says, well, others need to have the opportunity. And who am I going to use to reach these people?
Constantine put off his back, he called him the first Christian emperor, but he wasn't a Christian all his life. He put off his baptism until he thought he was going to die, because he thought if he could wait till he was going to die, then go straight to heaven without committing any sins.
That's right, yeah.
Because he'd been cleansed.
He's a bunker, yeah. Okay.
That's a good idea.
Good philosophy, that
is. Yeah.
So, done again.
He says, now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the spirit who is from God, so that we may know the things freely given to us by God, which things we also speak, not in words taught by human wisdom, but in those taught by the Spirit, combining spiritual thoughts with spiritual words. The Bible is the sword of the Spirit. The Bible is the Spirit's revealed words for what we like, what we can be like, and what He wants us to be like. It's God's guidebook for us to be the best that we can be as humanity. And it's amazing stuff. But it's because God has revealed who we are, where we came from, and what we're going to be doing. Exodus chapter 33 says, Moses said, I pray, show me your glory. And he said, I will make all my goodness pass before you. I will proclaim the name of the Lord before you. I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious. I will show compassion on whom I will show compassion. We cannot know him in his fullness, even with revelation. Even with all that God has revealed himself to us, we're still struggling. We're only catching a glimpse of who he is. I had a good illustration there, but okay. He says, you cannot see my face, for no man can see my face and live. The Lord said, behold, there is a place by me. You shall stand there on the rock. It will come about when I am glorious passing by. I will put you in the cleft of the rock and cover you with my hand until I have passed by. Then I will take my hand away, and you shall see my back, but my face you shall not see. Nobody has seen God. Okay? We get the hymn. He hides us in the cleft. He covers us in the cleft of the rock. Okay? The awesomeness of God.
And yet he didn't see God. He simply saw a manifestation of the presence of God.
Because he wouldn't be able to, he wouldn't be able to put God going past him. It's anthropomorphism.
Anthropomorphism is a good word.
He's using human terminology that we can understand it. But basically saying, you know, you're asking to see my glory. If you saw my glory, it would blow you away. I'll do something to demonstrate that you know who you're talking about.
A better word, Graham, is theophany.
A theophany. Yes. Same as
an appearance of God.
Abraham and the three angels, didn't they?
Yeah.
They were theophanies.
Theophany.
Described as God in his presence. Okay. So, we can't know knowledge fullness revelation without revelation. Job says, behold, there are the fringes of his ways. How faint a word we hear of him, but his mighty thunder, who can understand? Okay, so we just catch a small glimpse of what God has revealed to himself. Catch a small understanding of what could be understood about God. And yet that understanding is enough to say, wow, what a God, what an amazing God we have. Deuteronomy says the secret things belong to our Lord our God. The things revealed belong to us, to our sons forever, that we may observe all the words of this law. We know that the book of Deuteronomy in its very name is the second giving of the law of Moses. It was given there, first of all, in Exodus 20 on Mount Sinai. And what the word of God is saying here is that the word of the God has been revealed in his law. Part of the major input to the law was just God's holiness, God's understanding of the seriousness of sin and the consequences of sin. And so the giving of the law is helping us to understand that there are some things that are helpful for us, but some things are not helpful for us. And to be able to understand the difference between the two, that's a big area. God has been revealing to men and women through the precepts of reading this book by his blessings and his cursings. So he says, you know, there are things and there are consequences. There are things we can do, but remember, whatever you do or don't do, there's always consequences. Okay? The writer said, for evil to prosper, a good man need do nothing. Okay? So we see evil going on, and we stand back and allow it to go on, we'll have consequences of that. And one of them will be guilt. Why didn't we do something when we had the opportunity? You know, everything, good and bad, got the consequences. One of the basic lessons that we learn from these words before us is that God is a holy God, and his law was revealed to us. He's a righteous God. His eyes cannot look upon iniquity, and therefore his law portrays and conveys that truth to us. God is a God of light. In him is no darkness at all. And in our lives, we're a mix of light and dark. And God wants to chase away the darkness out of our lives, because he knows that that would help us to live that much closer to him, a purer life and holier life. So he challenges us by what he has shown us. So we'll stop there.
At night, all cats are grey. At night, all cats are grey.
All cats are grey, yes. At night, in the dark, yeah.
Green eyes as well.
And they've got?
Green eyes.
Green eyes as well, in the dark. Or red, are they? A little bit cats.
Headlights.
Yes. Okay, so hopefully, in these lessons, we'll catch a glimpse of God. Okay? I wish, you know, I had a greater ability to share more about the God we worship. So I'm only, you know, I'm stumbling as much in the dark as you really, to try and help you to see God more clearly. But you struggle to, if you can only describe what you've seen. And so I've only seen so much, and I'm going to try and pass that on to you. But there's so much more about God that I've not even touched in the garment.
It's all in the book, Graham.
It is. It is. That's yeah. That's a good reference.
It's there. We've got to dig it out.
That's right.
Little things like, as I live and breathe, so there's oxygen in heaven.
who says that?
As I live and breathe, says the Lord.
Oh.
Yeah, in the Old Testament.
I'm sure
it says that.
Yeah.
Oh. Yeah.
I've never heard that. I don't think I've ever read that.
Well, I'm going to look it up tonight, Frank.
Right,
came across
as I
live
and breathe.
And it stuck in my mind. I thought, that must be it.
That's
oxygen in heaven.
No, it's a Second Opinions chapter 3, that is.
Yeah, that's what it is.
Or Third Corinthians.
Third Corinthians.
The Gospel according to John.
Yeah, could be. Could be.
Yeah. Good.
A good one.
Only fairies and genies grant wishes.
The what?
Only fairies and genies
grant wishes. He said he wishes.
Oh, I see.
No, unless you believe in fairies and genies, grant wishing.
Fairies is a demon, though, isn't it?
Genies. When he's finished.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Heavenly Father.